अभी लाइव राहुल?
यस सर।
So we're going to start this webinar in 2 minutes. We're still waiting for a couple of participants. Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon, everybody. We're just waiting for a couple of minutes. I think we're all set to go. Just give us a couple of minutes. I think we have many people who have registered and who are now, you know, logging in. We've had a record number of participants, people who are interested in this webinar. More than 800 people have registered. And we'll give everybody 2 or 3 minutes before we start our presentation. Yeah. We're already live. We're just waiting for 2 minutes for you.
So let's give it another a minute or so. We're almost at that number. So just another minute or so.
It's very nice to see that we can broadcast, you know, this live to an audience which is not just in India, but also in many other countries like Japan and parts of Africa, Singapore. We have a few of our very interested partners who are also today watching this presentation. I believe that you know, the technology available today has really made the world quite seamless, and we are able to pass on and transfer information so easily, you know, from wherever to wherever.
TK sir, we are ready to go. We can start the webinar, sir.
We can go ahead. Okay, Rahul, thanks very much. Good afternoon, everybody. We have received an overwhelming response with more than 800 registrations for this webinar. I would like to thank everybody for registering and spending their valuable time with us. I hope that at the end of this presentation, you would have received a complete clarity on the challenges and opportunity of manufacturing PPE products. I'd like to introduce the speakers in today's program. Let me start with myself. My name is Pavan Kapoor, and I am one of the founders of IIGM, a company we established in 1980 to provide technology and service to the then apparel industry in India. During these 40 years, we have become one of the largest agents and distributors of over 40 international brands whose products we market and service through a pan-India operation of 15 offices and over 500 technical people. Some of the major brands that we deal with include Supply Scientific, the inventors of CAD/CAM products from the US, Eastman, over 100-year-old company and a manufacturer of cutting equipment, Juki, the world's largest industrial sewing machine producer, Yamato, a premium company from Japan manufacturing sewing equipment for the knitwear industry, Hashima, manufacturers of fusing and needle detection machines from Japan, Barudan, the originators of computerized multi-head embroidery machines, Wilcom, the world's largest software company for embroidery and printing, Eaton, the originator and manufacturer of unit production systems, Nagaishin, a world famous company for in-process engineering, Tonello, a very well-known company for industrial washing and other wet and dry applications, and so on. IIGM has also become a lead supplier of infrastructure products, which include electrical distribution and many other lighting and cooling ventilation products for green buildings. To sum up, our goal is to help manufacturers in India become the world's largest premium destination with respect to product quality, follow international regulations and compliance, and work in a healthy environment and workplace. The second speaker of today is Mr. Jasbir Singh Dodi, Managing Director of Sewing Systems Private Limited, a company which we established over four decades ago, which specializes in high quality interlining trims and supplying world-class products from companies in Europe and the Far East. Jasbir is a well-traveled guy and has been associated with all the top brands in the country, including Van Heusen, Louis Philippe, Raymond's, BlackBerry, JCPenney, Mothercare, and so on. We also have with us Mr. Ram, who has grown up from the ranks in IIGM and is presently the Vice President of Sales, handling many regions both in India and overseas. He has specialized knowledge on engineering applications for a number of industries, including apparel, automotive, furniture, bags, shoes, and other non-apparel products as well. Mr. Prashant Agarwal, a textile graduate from the Technological Institute of Textile and Sciences and an MBA from IMS Indore, he has been deeply involved in manufacturing, sourcing, and marketing of leading apparel, textile and apparel companies in India. He has also been deeply involved in consulting for various companies involving corporate strategy, business creation, diversification, and performance enhancement assignments in textile, apparel, and the retail sector, both within India and international clients. The COVID-19 pandemic has brought most of humanity to a standstill. This disease has brought whole new challenges on how to run our lives and livelihoods. It is as if we are opening a whole new chapter in our lives. Many of us are now working from home. The fact that we are on this webinar today itself shows a whole new form of communication which was alien to us not very long ago. Buying online is the new normal. Physical distancing, social distancing, wearing protective wear, face masks, and a whole new paradigm to personal hygiene, sanitization of the workplace and ourselves appears to be the new normal. Like all businesses, the apparel industry is no exception to this strange phenomena of the COVID-19. Being the second largest employer in India after agriculture, it is bound to see large-scale disruption, at least in the short term. One can visualize the new protocol for managing workers at workplaces, changed factory layouts to attain physical distancing, and far more rigid compliance from overseas buyers on our manufacturing methods. The use of IoT to enable machines to talk to each other and provide a seamless flow of information in the manufacturing space, lesser handling of fabrics and cut pieces, and a quick throughput would be necessary to achieve these objectives. The pandemic has brought new opportunities to the apparel industry in India. A recent study indicates that India is already the second largest producer of PPE suits after China. There has been a concerted effort by the government of India and factories to deliver on the requirement of the nation for both PPE suits as well as face masks. The existing ban for exports has already been lifted for face masks, and it is only a matter of time that this covers PPE suits as well. This would make India an attractive manufacturing destination to supply these products to the rest of the world. They say that in every crisis, there is a hidden opportunity, and one can visualize this clearly for the apparel industry in India. We have put together a small presentation today that covers all the essential inputs and information required for manufacturing these products. The webinar is going to be in two parts. The first one, which is today, would cover all aspects of manufacturing PPE suits, including technology, fabrics, trims, and compliances. The second part of this webinar, which will be held on the 11th of June, would cover the manufacturing of face masks, both with semi-automatic and automatic machines. At this stage, we also intend to dwell on sanitization and other products which are relevant for manufacturing companies and the welfare of our labor force. As with all webinars, we request everybody to WhatsApp their questions to the number given on each of these slides, and we will try to answer them once the presentations are completed. Now, coming to the agenda. The first part of our presentation would be a small COVID-19 video which actually explains the extent of the destruction that this COVID-19 has done to society. The second part would be on fabrics and trims by Sewing Systems by Jasveer, along with the compliance, which is actually focused on exports. We'd follow that up with the construction of a PPE suit using both classical methods as well as the ultrasonic method. What are the different machineries that we need, and work aids would also be explained in detail along with some videos. And lastly, we would do a case study of the Andhra Medical Tech Zone AMTZ, which is the premium medical tech body today in the country. We are very fortunate that we have with us Mr. Prashant Agarwal from Wazir Advisors, and he will cap it up with giving his views on the world trends, you know, in the PPE and the healthcare space. So over to you guys.
NHK is conducting an experiment with a group of researchers. The team will track particles in the air using laser beams and a high-sensitivity camera. This technology allows us to detect droplets as small as 0.1 micrometers wide. The experiment starts. First, sneezing. We can see a large droplet, about 1 millimeter in diameter. It quickly falls. But let's look through the high sensitivity camera. We can see small particles that seem to glitter floating through the air. These particles are all smaller than 10 micrometers, or 1/100th of a millimeter in diameter. Let's take a look from a different angle. They're small and light. You can see them drifting through the air. These are micro droplets. We're learning that sneezing isn't the only source of these droplets. We ran the same experiment on a close-range conversation. People generate a lot of micro droplets when they talk loudly. The droplets between these two stay where they are. They don't drift away. It's not yet known what volume of micro droplets leads to infection. But Tatida says we can't rule out the possibility that micro droplets have spread the virus to some extent.
その、マイクロ飛沫小さな粒子の中にもたくさんのですね、生きたウイルスがいて、大きな声での会話、あるいは激しい息遣い、そういった中でですね、このマイクロ飛沫ができて、それが近くの人、その人が吸い込むことによって感染が広がる、そういったリスクが見えてきたものと思います。
As more information about COVID-19 virus emerges, we are understanding that the size of this virus and the mobility of the virus as a pathogen is very important for us to first understand in order to address the challenges we face as a human race. The size of the COVID-19 virus varies between 60 to 140 nanometers, and the WHO has declared the median to be at 100 nanometer or 0.1 micron. This makes it smaller than all bacteria and the PM2.5 dust particle. COVID-19 virus moves in micro droplets, which are approximately 1 micron in diameter, and therefore certification of medical personal protective gear is very important. The primary human-to-human transmission of COVID-19 happens by direct contact with the pathogen, either by inhaling it through our nose and mouth, or by direct contact with our eyes. The compliance challenges for personal protective equipments, which include coveralls, gowns, surgical and non-surgical masks, and face and eye shields, have to be better understood. Strict compliance in manufacturing of PPE is essential in order to win this pandemic war against COVID-19 virus. This presentation is going to be broken up into two distinct categories. The first part will focus on the manufacturing of coveralls and gowns under PPE, and the second part will exclusively focus on mask manufacturing and the various types of masks available out there.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Jasbir Singh Dhodi, and I will be covering my presentation in two parts. The first part will be about fabrics and trims required for production of PPE coverall suits. And the second part will be about certification and compliance. As can be seen on the screen, the main articles that you require for a PPE coverall are a spun-bonded, non-woven laminated fabric, or a melt-blown breathable fabric, or a vinyl woven taffeta for reusable suits, a self-adhesive tape, heat seam sealing tapes, a coil zipper, and a double-sided polyester tape. So what is the main fabric being used today by 95% of factories producing PPE garments, especially coveralls? It is a basic spun-worn, non-woven, laminated fabric. As can be seen, it's a non-reusable PPE coverall. It has very less breathability. It also has only one requirement to meet. That is, the requirement was ASTM 1670, which I'll come to later. But most importantly, it's a very economical PPE fabric. That's why the reason why it's very popular at the moment. The second one, which is going to become very important in the future, both for India and export, is a melt-blown breathable fabric. You may hear the terms being used, SMS and SSMMS. What do these terms mean? SMS would be a spun, melt-blown spun layer. SSMMS would be two layers of spun, two layers of melt-blown, and a spun. As can be seen, one of the highlights of this type of fabric is it has higher breathability, obviously because it is non-laminated. It also requires a basic certification of ASTM 1670. The third fabric, which a lot of companies in India are now testing out, is what is called as a vinyl taffeta fabric for making reusable suits. As is well known, the non-woven laminated fabric suit cannot be reused. Once it is used and taken off, the life of that PPE is gone. The future is going to be where a lot of reusable suits will be required. But of course, even the reusable suit fabric has to meet certain standards. In addition to meeting standard number 6, as you see on the screen, which is basically ASTM 1670, the other products will also be involved when we testing off the tensile strength and tensile elongation. So when you look at a fabric reusable, you should definitely ask your manufacturer for the 6 parameters listed on the screen, which is essential if you want to use a reusable PPE coverall fabric. Basically, when the PPE production started, there was a requirement to seal the seams. When the seam is made, the needles are punching holes in the fabric and those seams have to be sealed. So for a lot of time in the beginning of March and to some extent even now, a basic self-adhesive tape was being used. It used to have only 2 criteria. It has to be antibacterial and it also has to pass an ASTM F1670 test, just like the fabric. But a thumb rule you can use when you're using a self-adhesive tape is, what is the bond strength? The bond strength should be a minimum of 20 Newton. It's easy to do that test. If your self-adhesive tape does not pass that, please do not use the tape. The main tapes which are recommended for medical PPEs are, of course, heat seam sealing tapes. In fact, they're also called as medical PPE tapes. These are basically a 2-layer seam sealing tape, appropriately made depending on the type of fabric that you're going to use. A typical 2-layer seam sealing tape should have a minimum thickness between 0.12 mm to 0.15 mm. And it also has to pass an ASTM D1238 standard. That is the melting standard, which do not worry at this time. Basically, we'll talk about this later when the machines are done. Okay, when you talk of heat seam sealing tape, you will also be hearing about 2 types of tapes, what is called as PE EVA coated and PU tapes. PE EVA coated is a polyethylene EVA coated tape, which is done with the help of a machine sealing the seam. But most importantly, it is very, very suitable for the basic non-woven spun bonded laminated fabric, which also has a lamination very suitable for PPE tapes. The other tape you can see on the right of the screen is a polyurethane tape. I take your attention to the last point. A polyurethane tape withstands sanitizing. So therefore, when you are going to use a reusable fabric, you should definitely go for a polyurethane tape. Mostly the woven fabric itself will be PU coated. So you need a PU tape to be used on seaming of a PU coated fabric. How does the covert warrior wear the PPE overall or garment? Mostly 90% of them are being made with the coil zipper number 5 or number 3. Make sure that the coil zipper is plastic. You do not have a metal puller. Apart from that, there are no compliances except to make sure that the zipper that you're using withstands at least 10 to 12 times. It should withstand opening and closing, even though it's just used for a one-time use fabric. The next trim that you will be using mostly in PPE coverall suits is what is called as a double-sided polyester tape. This tape is used in the flap. When you have the zip, you see the PPE coverall construction, there is a flap which covers the tape. So to see that the flap remains in place, the flap is covered with a double-sided polyester tape, which can vary from 20 to 24 to 36 mm. There are no compliances as such. Make sure that the tape is of good quality. That's about it. The second part, very, very important for anybody making a PPE medical garment, are compliance and certifications. The most basic compliance certification that you would have seen, whether it was a fabric or PPE suit, is what is called as Test ASTM F1670. What does ASTM stand for? It's basically American Society for Testing of Materials. So these are American standards which are presently being used by the government. As you can see on the screen, there is an Indian version of it called ISO 16603. These are screening tests for only one thing, to see resistance of the material to synthetic blood penetration. This can be best understood by the forthcoming video now.
ASTM F1670 is the standard test method for resistance of materials used in protective clothing to penetration by synthetic blood. The protective clothing sample is fixed in a cell for continuous contact. Synthetic blood is then added to the sample. Pressure is then added to simulate blood bursting. Droplet of liquid observed on the exposed side means failure to the test, as shown on the left of the video. The synthetic blood penetration test is the mandatory test done by CITRA and DRDO on all fabrics and tapes used in the manufacturing of personal protective equipments within India.
So on the screen, you see a sample of a CITRA report, which is basically covering an ASTM 1670 test. This test will be done for the fabrics or for the tapes or for the finished garments also. The second test on compliance is called the ASTM F1671. This is basically a viral penetration test. It is not so commonly being done at the moment, but for those who are looking at an export tomorrow to Europe or to America, it's called as a level 4 PPE test, the ASTM F1671, a viral penetration test, very important for the frontline doctors. The following video will give you an idea about what this test is all about.
ASTM F1671 is the globally recognized test for testing virus penetration in tapes and fabrics. PHIX-174 bacteriophage virus is used for this test. This virus is just 27 nanometers in size. A sample is prepared by cutting the fabric into a 3x3-inch square. It is then loaded into the reviser. Nutrient broth with the virus in it is then added to the reviser. It is then left to sit for 5 minutes. The pressure valve is then connected at 2 psi and left for 54 minutes. During this time, it is scanned for visual failure. If this visual failure appears, the test is stopped. The virus with the nutrient broth is drained from the reservoir. The reservoir is taken and then on the non-test side, sterile nutrient broth is poured in and kept for 5 minutes to capture any viruses. The broth is then recovered. It is then put into a test tube with E. coli and left overnight. If the color of the broth changes, it is an indicator that there are viruses present which are infecting the E. coli and it has failed the test. If not, it has passed the test.
So one very important point being discussed on TV panels and on newspapers also is about the fact that doctors, especially in the Indian environment, are facing a challenge. What is the challenge? The challenge faced by the government in PPE for the industry is to provide a fabric that, first of all, passes a blood penetration test 1670, a virus penetration test 1671, at the same time making these fabrics breathable so that medical personnel do not suffocate. Obviously, the breathability of the fabric depends on the fabric base and the coating. So what are you seeing on the screen are basically standards. The ASTM E96 is a standard to measure breathability. You can see here the breathability is measured in terms of grams per square meter in 24 hours. It means how many grams of moisture vapor can pass through a square meter of the material in 24 hours. There are three ranges here: low, less than 4,000, moderate, 4,000 to 8,000, high, more than 9,000. Unfortunately, 95% of the PPE garment overalls being made in India today are even less than 2,000. That's why I said the challenge is to get a breathability fabric. This is a brief about solid system scheme all over the country, which you can contact for anything related to fabrics and compliances. I would like to give a word of caution to all the members who are watching the webinar. Please be doubly careful with terms of the quality of the material that you are using, because ultimately the doctor, the nurse using this fabric depends upon you. Secondly, apart from the product, we only talked about the product specification. There are also manufacturing specifications in terms of how your factory is to be laid out. And that is where my next speaker, Mr. Ram from IIGM, will take over. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ram, Vice President IIGM. First of all, I would like to thank Mr. Jasbir, Managing Director of SPL, for giving us a comprehensive overview on different kinds of fabrics and trims to be used for PPE and compliance requirements. In this part of my presentation, I'm going to talk about two different methods of making PPE. One is so popular called classical method, which is basically a strip and seam sealing process. Another one is ultrasonic welding. In general, medical grade PPE is of two types. One is a coverall, which we call it as a PPE suit. It basically has a top along with full sleeve body attached to the trouser waistband. It also comes with a pair of shoe covers. Another one is gown. Both these garments are made of reusable and non-reusable types. Before I take you through in detail, I would like to brief you few key differences between coveralls and gowns. In general, there is a significant difference between the design of traditional coveralls and gowns. All coveralls typically provide 360-degree protection because they are designed to cover the whole body. The design of gowns do not provide continuous whole body protection. For example, possible openings in the back cover to the mid-calf only. So manufacturers should consider the garment design as a part of the production process. Unfortunately, no clinical studies have been done to compare the efficacy of gowns versus coveralls. However, both these garments have been effectively used by healthcare workers in clinical settings during the patient care. Therefore, other factors need to be considered when comparing gowns and coveralls during the selection process. When the material and seam barrier properties are essential for defining production, the coverage provided by material used in the garment design, as well as certain features including closures, will greatly affect the protection. For example, a coverall with a front zipper closure could result in compromise of barrier protection if plastic zipper used in its construction and not with a flap of barrier material can be sealed to the garment. During the patient care, the risk of anticipated exposure is typically in the area of front chest and sleeves. Thus, gowns are frequently used in healthcare. Most of the surgical gowns rated for higher levels of barrier protection may include high-performance barrier materials only in certain portions of a gown, especially sleeves and front panel. Gowns, on the other hand, are relatively easy to put on and in particular to take off. Therefore, they are generally more familiar to healthcare workers. The level of heat stress generated due to added layer of clothing is also expected to be less for gowns than coveralls due to many reasons, which includes the openings in the designs of the gowns and the total area covered by the fabric. Therefore, for gowns, it is important to have sufficient overlap of fabric so that it wraps around the body to cover the back, ensuring if the wearer squats or sits down, the gown still protects the back area of the body. In the first part of my presentation, I am going to explain about construction of a PPE suit using classical method. And in the second part, gowns using ultrasonic welding. As you can see from this slide, we have illustrated about the various sewing and seam sealing processes involved at the front section of a coverall. As the most commonly used fabric is a non-woven, in the construction of a PPE suit, we recommend to use four-thread overlock machine for all attaching processes and single needle lock stitch for zipper attaching. Hood facing, sleeve, bottom hemming portions as an elastic attached to the fabric for proper closure. In addition, we have explained the sewing and seam sealing operations involved in the rear. The last portion is the shoe part. Here we have explained the sewing and seam sealing operations for making shoe covers. In classical method, basically the entire garment is sewn first and then it goes to seam sealing. As explained already, most common machines used to manufacture a non-reusable coverall are overlocks and single needle lock stitch machines. For elastic tapes, which generally come in roll form, and to feed accurate amount of tape, we recommend to use four-thread overlock machine with an electronic measuring device for hood face, sleeve, and bottom hemming operations. Hot air seam sealing machines are used for tape sealing to cover the sewn seam. Here, I would like to introduce one of our esteemed business partner, Juki Corporation. Many of us are aware that Juki is a renowned brand worldwide, and they manufacture wide range of industrial sewing machines for apparel, leather and heavy duty, upholstery, and automotive industries. Juki is the only company who can offer complete range of sewing solutions for various products. Their offering includes basic, semi-automatic and fully automatic machines to meet various needs. We will now show you a few videos of the operations in making PPE with Juki brand industrial sewing machines. The operation which you see is a zipper attaching operation, basically done on a single needle lock stitch machine. The second one is the four-threaded overlock operation for joining panels. DDL-8000A model is one of the latest eco-friendly single-headed lock switch machine from Juki. It has a wider arm width comparing to the traditional models, which facilitates easy handling of largest panels during sewing. The lubrication mechanism is semi-dry in this model, which means the needle bar room is completely oil-free to avoid oil stains. Instead of oil, very high-quality grease is used for lubrication. It is lubricated with minimal quantity of oil from the built-in oil tank. So there is a clean circulation of oil to the hook part and the oil return is coming back to the tank. Oil can be monitored on the panel. Large LCD user-friendly panel is provided to control various functions of the machine. Auto foot lifter and shorter thread type are available at customer choice. Overlock machines are with two kinds of lubrication system. MO6800S S-type comes with fully automatic lubrication and D-type comes with semi-dried lubrication. The semi-dried lubrication is to avoid oil stains on the garment. These models are designed to run at 7000 SPM and all other functions remain same in both these models. Here we are coming to the main part of the presentation. Hot air machine comes in two different kinds of technology. Here I'd like to introduce our high-end model iShark ISMH62, which uses compressed air as media to generate hot air. The compressed air passes through a high quality heater, 3 kilowatt, to generate hot air anywhere between 50 degree to 800 degree at the nozzle point. This is a post bed machine with top and bottom rollers. Inclined bottom post for easy handling of the garment. Digital tape feeder comes as standard to feed accurate amount of tape required. PLC control mechanism with large touchscreen panel is provided to control temperature, tape speed, nozzle and roller pressure, etc. Upper roller width is 25 mm and lower roller width is 31 mm as standard. 18.5 meter per minute is the maximum speed of the machine. It comes with unique reduced nozzle of 22 mm size, which is interchangeable to provide uniform temperature all times. Differential feed mechanism is being adopted in this model, which means both top and bottom rollers are driven by independent stepping motors. Independent regulators are provided to control nozzle and roller pressures separately. These are few value-added features which facilitates wide range of applications possible using this model. Importance of high-quality seaming machines for PPE and its other applications is critical. And these machines have limited use unless we are able to handle different types of fabrics and seam sealing tapes on a variety of applications on products such as activewear, driving suits, bathing suits, rainwear, waterproof shoes, etc. This point needs to be understood while making a decision to avoid compliance issues in future. Now you can have a look at our high-end model ISMH video.
Thank you. As you can see, the configuration of the seam sealing machine should be able to cover all sewn seams with a seam sealing tape. This application is done by fusing the heat sealing tape on the seam of the garment. In this video, the process shown is on spun bonded laminated fabric around 70 GSM. The heat seam sealing tape is a PE plus EVA coated tape around 20 mm in width. The digital tape feeding device provides a positive feed of the adhesive tape. We can accurately set the amount of feeding through the panel. An automatic tape cutting device is installed in the machine and can be operated by the foot pedal. The top and bottom roller are driven by independent step motors, thereby providing differential feed systems to handle different types of fabrics and tapes. This nozzle can be replaced for different widths of seam tape. The digital screen controls all parameters, which include tape, speed, nozzle pressure, roller pressure, etc. A knee switch is provided to operate a solenoid for releasing the roller and the tape whenever required. iShark ISM H62 can be used with woven fabrics using polyurethane lamination. We recommend PU tape for this application. For non-woven fabrics such as spun-bond polypropylene with PE lamination, the corresponding tapes used is PE and EVA.
This is another model, iShark ISMH52. This model comes with a built-in blower to produce air, which passes through a high-quality heater to generate hot air up to 700 degrees Celsius at nozzle point. Comes with manual feeding tape feeding system as standard. Mechanical control system for stable and smooth feeding of tape from tape spool to rollers. In this model, digital tape feeder is available as option. Both upper and lower roller width is 25 mm as standard. Is provided to control both roller and nozzle pressure. In this model, a suction pipe is provided as standard to remove the hot air around the nozzle. Thus, working place more convenient. As the blower starts only during the seam sealing process, there is a significant saving on power and air consumption. Again, differential feed mechanism, inclined post, reduced and interchangeable nozzle, PLC control system with touchscreen panel are few other value addition to this product. iShark hydrostatic tester is an essential machine required for in-house quality testing. It is primarily used to check water repellency on laminated fabric panels and also to check the tensile strength of the seam seal tapes on laminated fabrics by applying water at a high pressure for a few seconds. We strongly recommend to use this machine as a part of compliance and to avoid rejections and claims from buyers. Now we will show you a quick
iShark hydrostatic tester is used in the internal quality audit for both the finished PPE medical grade garment and the fabrics and trims used in the manufacturing of the same. The hydrostatic tester simulates pressure testing of the garment similar to ASTM F1670 synthetic blood penetration test. It ensures resistance of the medical grade garment to body fluid penetration. This equipment is a part of the internal quality control audit as part of the compliance requirements for medical grade testing.
Here is a snapshot of list of machines required along with quantity and sample value. This slide. This is to produce 500 pieces of coveralls in 9 hours working shift at 70% efficiency. Estimate project cost to produce 500 pieces excluding cutting section and packing section. Cutting section can be either manual or fully automated depending on production capacity. Here I would like to introduce two of our esteemed business associates for your cutting room solutions. For fully automated and seamless integration of cutting room facility, we can offer CAD, CAS and CAM solutions from Gerber Technology USA and Eastman for manual and semi-automatic solutions. This slide explains the entire list of machines required for sewing and seam sealing process. Apart from doing several other projects for PPE, we are glad to share about MTZ project, which was a very special turnkey project that IHM did with end-to-end solutions. IHM is an accredited supplier to the Indian government for all types of sewing and bonding machinery and solutions. We have for many years been setting up such state-of-the-art facilities in various locations of the country. We handhold customers right from understanding the business processes involved to the ROI, offer right technology machines, and commissioning of the project. In this case, our PPE force team and project team has stood by the customer by deploying resources full time during the pre-production stage and also post-production. It is given that IHM specializes in maintaining their machines with a highly trained service team and stocks all essential spares. Now, let's show you a quick video of it.
AMTZ is Asia's largest integrated hub for making medical devices and is located in Vizag, Andhra Pradesh. Our projects team was involved from the design stage and made layouts from cut to pack. IGM has successfully handled PPE and E and N95 mask making projects on turnkey basis. We supplied Juki, Gerber, iShark, EAE and Eastman equipment for these projects.
Here is the layout our project team has made for the entire facility. This layout includes right from fabric warehousing to finished goods storage. Now, I will take you through an alternative process to manufacture coveralls and gowns using ultrasonic welding. Ultrasonic welding process is being used to make simple coveralls and gowns of medical grade for frontline workers, patients in isolation wards, and surgical needs. Here too, the fabric and trims have to be compliant to ASTM F1670 for domestic and ASTM F1671 for exports. Ultrasonic machines are widely used in many industries and for various applications as explained in this slide. We have two models. ISMB 90180A comes with a single motor to drive both upper and lower rollers. ISMB 9018 comes with two different motors to control the feeding of upper roller and lower roller. 60 meters per minute is the maximum speed of this machine. Power consumption varies between 1.5 kilowatt to 2.5 kilowatt depending on the model selection. Frequency is 20 hertz. For scrap welding, we have another model called ISMB 9020. Here are the few applications possible using ultrasonic machines on non-woven fabrics. Now I request you to kindly have a look at the video of both models.
iShark ISMB9018B ultrasonic welding machine is used in lace attaching, strap preparation, and joining all panels of a surgical gown. This video demonstrates the joining of two non-woven fabric panels. This process is also known as lace attaching operation. Here we see panel cutting operation for straps using the ultrasonic welding machine. The raw edges are accurately trimmed, similar to an edge cutting machine. iShark ISMB9018B comes with independent motors for driving upper and lower rollers. In this video, the panel edge cutting operation on woven fabrics is demonstrated. iShark ISMB9020 ultrasonic strap welding machine is used for attaching the strap to the surgical gown.
Thank you very much. This brings us to the end of our presentation on technology. Now I am giving you a snapshot of our next webinar, which is scheduled for the 11th of June. In this webinar, we will show you fully and semi-automatic solutions for making N95 and disposable protective masks. Solutions for air circulation with large factories with iShark brand HVLS fans, air circulation fans, and industrial exhaust fans. Thermal body scanner, consumables and sanitation products. Here, change layout would mean bright floor marking on factory floors, epoxy floors and bright floor marking in factory floors. Body temperature thermometer reader. Why to choose us? IIGM is a pan-India organization and has 15 branches across India. We have over offices in Jordan, Bangladesh, Ethiopia, and Hong Kong. Our experts in Hong Kong office is helping us in sourcing right technology and high quality machines from reputed manufacturers in China. So we assure you of delivering you the very best technology and high quality products from China.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's Prashant Agarwal, co-founder of Wazir Advisors. We are a management consulting firm focused on strategy, operations, and alliances in India and globally. I'll thank IIGM. They have given a very good insight in terms of fabrics, tapes, machines to use to make globally acceptable product. Now, I think we need to really understand where do we stand in terms of textile and apparel industry and what is the opportunity here. Today, if you see with COVID, focus on healthcare industry will increase globally and opportunity will be there for complete textile and apparel industry. Global market size is big, will increase exponentially. Key concerns need to be addressed to be a global player in this industry. I think this is what we understand and what's a way forward for us. Next. So when we talk about healthcare opportunity for textile and apparel players, since the COVID-19 outbreak, demand for healthcare products have jumped many folds, especially in surgical and N95 masks and protective clothing such as gowns and coveralls. Heavy investments are undertaken by big and small manufacturers across the globe to tap this opportunity. Even the developed nations are trying to become self-sufficient, more so in case of masks. But it is important for us to note that coveralls, because of manpower deployment, is still needs to be outsourced by manufacturing intensive destinations. Even in India, with 1.3 billion people, demand for masks and coveralls for healthcare will be huge. I think we have a global market and domestic market which needs to be taken care of. When we talk about global market size, I think it's coverall and masks already exist. So we have cover all markets today in 2019 around $1.61 billion and mass was around $2.15 billion. Today, post-COVID, we see an addition of 5x volumes in coverall and mass almost 10x. So the market size post-COVID, we see for coveralls almost $3.6 billion and mass almost around $8.6 billion. And which, but while the quantity is increasing, the volume is increasing, we will see a huge reduction in price also because competitiveness will come. So almost 50 to 60% reduction in price points are going to happen for both coveralls and masks. But as I told, it's a manufacturing labor intensive industry for coveralls. So what will be the, who will be the major manufacturing nations? Same China, India, Vietnam, Taiwan, Bangladesh. So we have an opportunity where we are going to supply to major importing nations like US, EU, Middle East. And while this COVID is not that this is only in Western world, it has gone to each and every country. So these requirements are going to be there globally. Are we competitive? So again, when we say it has to be manufactured in countries like India, China, and Vietnam, but we need to see that we need to have the right products, right machines, right processes being followed so that we meet international quality standards. So while all of this looks good, but we need to be perfect. We need to really ensure much more methodical working, more than what we used to do for garment making, because a lot of things are at stake here. Next. So what are the key concerns for coverall suppliers? Because after understanding there is big market, there's an opportunity, there are players who can supply you machines and everything. I think very important point, slide for all of you to consider. First, achieving desired quality level of finished product. When earlier in few months, when demand was huge and wanting people were wanting to buy any kind of product, we could make up with anything. But future will not be like this. Availability of standard raw material like fabric, tapes, etc. will be a big issue. Ensuring right productivity of line. So when we are saying it's a manufacturing intensive industry, ensuring that what we produce is of best standard and we produce the numbers which are required to become cost competitive. So productivity is important. Optimum utilization of special machines, developing export quality products once exports are allowed, which government is going to allow probably by month end. So if this is allowed, what we are making will not suffice. You have to follow all standards which are given in today's presentations. Meeting quality requirements, which will be stringent because of strict medical standards, not a simple fashion industry. Next. So I think after considering the way forward for all of you who wanting to invest in this industry, four important points to consider. Product engineering. Understanding correct product design and performance requirements, defining right operational bulletin for each product and streamlining production accordingly. Meeting global standards, because you can't focus only on Indian market. The demand is there globally and India has to supply this product globally. Understanding product quality and service requirements of buyers. Understanding product testing and certification requirement will be very, very important when you go globally. Research and development. Focusing on product design and innovation to sustain for long term, investing in state-of-art technologies and SOPs to deliver better quality products. Most important part is partnership with best quality raw material suppliers. There will be a lot of players. We will talk about cost reduction. They will be offering at different price points, but genuine high performance material will remain in short supply for next couple of years. So long-term commitment with suppliers can help preserve supply chain because there'll be times when the material is not available, even if available is not good quality. So you have machines, you don't have material. So partnership is the way forward in this. I think this is broadly what I wanted to explain because this is a really focused industry which has future, but for those who really focus on manufacturing excellence. Thank you.
Thanks, Prashant. That was very concise, but I think you put all the challenges and all the solutions there on your presentation. Fantastic. I have a few questions for you. which I am really taking out from all this number of questions that we've been getting. We've been a very responsive kind of seminar that we've been having. We're getting a lot of feedback from a lot of our viewers. And so I thought I'll pose a few questions to you first, since you have a lot of experience of what's happening around the world and also in India, and you're in touch with the government and many other agencies around the country. The first point that I want to ask you is that clearly, as we see that in the last few months, China has had a huge head start in this business. While the rest of the world is suffering, China seems to be up and around and in business, and they have been very, very active in supplying PPE products and PPE machinery and everything else connected with PPE around the world. So where do you think India would fit in as an alternative global player, especially considering that this heated rhetoric which is there in the world today that we see against China? So where do you think this, where India could be, a serious contender in this business?
Thanks, Pawanji. I think very important question you asked. And what has happened that today China is the only country which is able to supply. So as you rightly said, they had a head start. But people are looking to buy from other countries. And India is a really good option because we have good kind of fabrics also available for these. So if we have raw material and if we are able to put up capacities of scale and use the right quality of machines and raw material, I think people will come and buy from India. It's a huge opportunity. Market is big. So commitment to China, because this is a standard product, the commitment to China can be changed much faster than what it could be changed in apparel and textile industry. So I think the key will be, instead of trying to see what is my profit, first set the process so that you produce the right quality. If this is done, I think you don't have to search for markets. Today, China is supplying containers and containers of it.
Yeah, I think that's an extremely valid point. I remember from all the TV, news that we were getting about substandard products being supplied from certain China sources and so on and so forth. I think we may also fall into the same trap if we don't follow your advice.
Yes, absolutely. That's the key.
You see, eventually what we have noticed is that this is a new product and it's also a new opportunity. Right. And so if you are able to get the product right, if you are able to get, when you say global standards, I can't see the difference between a global standard and an Indian standard. Standards are standards. After all, we're talking about lives, and it doesn't matter whether it's an American life or a European life or an Indian life. So standards have to be set, understood, and implemented.
I think, Pawanji, you rightly said, the only point I would say, some standards are same everywhere. Compliance focus is really missing somewhere. There you get away with that. And when you export, I don't think it's going to miss, and you might end up sending shipments and they won't pay you anything if you are not in line with the international standards.
Absolutely. Very, very valid point. There's another very interesting point that was brought up. In this challenge that we are facing today, there's a lot of talk going on around the country of how much we can produce and so on and so forth. Is the challenge really about textile or is it about apparel? Is the real challenge that we face in terms of becoming a global player, is it connected to textile manufacturing of spun bonded material or PU material, as our earlier speakers were saying? Are we talking about a material problem, or are we talking about a manufacturing apparel problem?
So I would say clearly it is not material problem as of today. We have enough of spun bond material, but people are using different kinds of lamin. We have to identify right suppliers and then work with them. And after that, it's more to do with process. Tapes today are majorly being imported. You can still import. There can be manufacturing here. But if you use, I think in the way you have explained the machinery, each and every process, if that is used, I think that will be the key for exports. Material, we have enough here and we can import also for some time. And if there are capacities which can be upgraded very, very fast. So I think manufacturing operations is the key.
Wonderful. Okay, there was one question that came up for Jasbir Singh, which is PPE material biodegradable? And that was number, question number one. The second question was, is Chinese seam sealing tapes good? Are Chinese seam sealing tapes good? These are the two questions which came up from Jasbir Singh. So if you would like to answer that.
Let me answer the first question. When you talk of polypropylene PPE, you have to compare it to plastic. See, plastic will biodegrade somewhere between 300 to 350 years. Whereas the PPE, by its nature and composition, biodegrades between 25 to 30 years. So the biodegradability of PPE is much, much faster than plastic. Number two, PPE is, it can be recycled, 100% recycled. And what is important to note that when you recycle PPE, there are no toxins released. So a lot of people say when you recycle something, could there be a dangerous toxin? No. Fortunately, in PPE, when you recycle it, very, very less quantity of toxins are received, which are within the safeguard zone. Coming to the second question, this heat seam sealing tapes, as Mr. Prashant rightly mentioned, this requirement was not very big in India till recently. So there are only international players who are manufacturing this PPE tapes. Okay, even in the Chinese suppliers, there are high-end, medium-end, low-end. End of the day, you have to test the tape. You cannot go by the buyer or by the seller what he's saying. There are certain tests you do when you use the PPE seam sealing tape on your garment. That test is very, very important, especially because I've been hearing a lot of talk last about 2-3 weeks that a lot of garments are being rejected because of poor quality of tapes. And the tape quality has to be measured. Like I said, there is a standard when you use a heat seal tape. Of course, most importantly, high quality seam sealing machine. But once you seam seal with the heat sealing tape, when you try to take off the tape, the non-woven fabric should tear off. Not just the tape, the fabric itself tears off. That's a very good test. So don't go by the name of the supplier. You have to do a test inside your factory, mandatory.
That's great. You know, one of the, I was on another webinar a few days ago, and one of the points that, you know, one of the panelists had made is that all manufacturers of PPE equipment, be it, you know, be it on the mask side or on the PPE coverall side or whatever it is, must ensure that a certain number of, you know, standard testing procedures are available in-house. I think this is something that, you know, everybody has to learn and understand that you have to test. You have to test your seam sealing tapes. You have to test your seams. You have to test the fabric and whatever else you need to do. So you got to build in a testing facility in-house. I think that's an important point, you know, that you've also brought up.
Yeah, I may mention one thing, Pawan, here. As you have already shown, when it comes to this ASTM 1670, the blood penetration, you have this hydrostatic machine, which you are not using blood by using water. Viscosity of water is even more. So if that water test passes, 100% your garment will pass the blood permutation test. So hydrostatic test is going to become a must for somebody who wants to ensure a high quality PPE garment.
Thank you. Thank you, Jasbir. Last question for you, Prashant. Everybody wants to know, when do you think that the Indian government would be able to, vacate this ban? You know, we have a ban today for export of PPE. When do you think this ban will be vacated?
I had a discussion yesterday also after discussing with you. They are considering any moment to open this. Maybe I would say outer side month end. Even minister is interested to open it, the ban on PPE exports.
Would it be applicable both for the fabric as well as the product or only for the product?
Only for the product. But the issue here, I would say, Pawanji, more important issue is that once export is opened, are the PPE coveralls we are making exportable or not? I think that's a major issue because then only people will, once export is opened, people will come to know whether what product they are making exportable or not.
Right. But Prashant, you know, I deal with a number of manufacturers from India, you know, and they're highly capable companies. You know, they've been in the business for the last, as you all know, the last 30, 40 years. And these companies have also learned that, you know, there is no shortcut to the business. And, you know, they source the best fabrics, they serve, they use the best embellishments and the best manufacturing methods as well. So I believe Indian industry is ready for exports. The knowledge behind what is required in terms of compliances may be a little bit of an issue, but I think eventually this will also be, you know, something that we'll all learn and we'll all get there.
Bhavanji, I think it's a big opportunity for industry. The good point is we are starting afresh. It's right. A beginning. So right. We can start, we have to write on the clean slate. We can be better than China in this.
I think we will take that as a last point and say, you know, we have really no baggage.
Yes.
Fresh industry for it. We have absolutely no baggage and we can go about it, you know, with a fresh, clean slate and follow the right methods and the right way of doing, you know, of making this product and succeed. Thank you very much, gentlemen. I think we've slightly run out of time in this particular situation, but I hope that, you know, everybody has been able to learn something out of this webinar. Our idea is to bring you, you know, the best products, the best speakers, knowledge behind the whole story, and hope that, we get to see you soon again. And like I said, we're going to have our next webinar, you know, which is going to talk about, you know, how to make masks and, you know, all other products which is connected with sanitation and so on and so forth on the 11th. And you can, we will send you an invite again for that webinar. The last point that I wanted to make is, you know, we've also been receiving a lot of requests for people who are telling us to send this PPT presentations. Just wanted to make a point here that we are available. This presentation will be available on YouTube. And you can also download this presentation, or you could see this presentation from our website, www.iigm.in. Thank you very much and have a good day. Thank you and keep safe.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.